Good evening, Monrovia!
Dry up.
Okay, what happens?
All right, we're trying to get this show working, believe it or not, folks out there. You know, for all you couch potatoes out there, this is what I like to do. Now I'm looking at camera one. This is where I'm going to now. You know, for all you couch potatoes out there, this is where, oh, now we got it under control. All right, tell you, live show, anything can happen. We got two-armed Dae-Han Lee in there trying to make it happen.
I'm on the phone.
He's on the phone. Must be up. Hold on, hold the show. All right, here we go. Schoolboy's in trouble out there. I think I talked about that already. But in any event, you know what? For all you couch potatoes out there, I always like to start off the show with what's going on in the news for you couch potatoes that sort of like pay attention and don't pay attention. Well, you know, this month has been a month of travesty in many ways. You had the death of Wilt Chamberlain, and then you had the passing of Walter Payton, Chicago Bears, famous number 34, nicknamed Sweetness. Let's get a close shot on Sweetness right there. All right, his name, he was sweet not only because of his manner of running, but also because of his outgoing personality. And they had a tribute to him in Chicago. Another former great that seems to be in the newspaper, and that's Jim Brown. Okay? He says the judge is sexist. Another face that seems to stay in the news, and he's not coming back to play for the Lakers, but somehow he just stays in the news. And that's the worm. Dennis Rodman. Now, another subject that's back in the news is the logo for Arcadia High School, known as the Apaches. Okay, some American Indians find that very offensive. Okay, looking at this shot right here, this is a march in New York. Sort of like it says in many ways, let me get a tight shot of that right there. KKK has a rally in New York. I think it was 12 of them. And it was like, hey, daddy and mommy, what did you do in the 90s? Is this a Kodak moment? All right, who was the first black woman to win an Oscar? All right, Hedy McDaniels, Gone with the Wind. And you know, she had one wish, and she wanted to be buried in Hollywood Cemetery. And at that particular time, no blacks were allowed in the cemetery to be buried. And so now they're going to put up a plaque 50 years later, sort of way out, but I guess in time is okay. What else do we have here? Holiday for Cesar Chavez. He deserves a holiday. All right. When you think of the Chicago Bears, who else comes in mind other than Mike, other than Walter Payton and McMahon? How about that guy that's coach for the Saints? Old Mike Ditka. He was probably looking at you. Caught me grabbing my nuts, huh? But a fan below has something to say. We've been tricked. How about a treat? Oh, Mike Ditka. I guess he's probably saying, why did I go back into this game? And something on a positive note. It looks like an old headline, doesn't it? Tiger roars again, and it should be again. Because now he's, I'll put it simply, Tiger's the man. He's the $6 million man. All right? A swing of intensity. And this, I thought this captured Walter Payton right there. Now, maybe the death of Walter Payton might encourage more African Americans to be organ donors. We're sort of reluctant to give our organs for some particular reason. Why? I don't have a clue. Maybe a lack of education or maybe superstition. All right, you got some people laying around the house looking for a job? If you focus right in here, they say holiday work a shortage for the holidays. They're looking for young folks to come on out and fill out those employment applications. So if you got somebody in your house looking for a job, maybe they should take that article with them and say, hey. All right, could somebody tell me what is a monopoly? Now, Microsoft has been declared a monopoly. And the lower headlines tell you that viewers are sort of get confused, and all of a sudden, Lucky's becomes Albertson, and that's not a monopoly. Makes you wonder, what is a monopoly all about? Another case in point is pool cleaners unite to promote service. So if you got a swimming pool, maybe your rates may be going up. Okay. Somehow we're not getting it right. All right, here's, you know, political cartoons I just love. And this is a reflection for Elizabeth Dole. It's still a man's world. And that's probably dead presidents. And you notice there are no women on the paper currency. I know at one time they had a Susan B. Anthony. But somehow that fell out of circulation. Okay, what else do we have here? All right. There was a presidential quiz that happened to George W. Bush. Can you name five world leaders in the trouble spot? And he could only name one, and I believe that was in Pakistan, I do believe. So this cartoon says, can you name who's on a $20, a $50, and a $100 bill? You know, he's amassed a tremendous campaign chest. I think it's over $54 million in his run for the presidency. Political cartoons have a way of saying something that really captures your eye. Here's one for you. How about the Fight Club, starring Bill Clinton and Trench Lott? I don't know what they're battling over. Now, some people always wonder, how come black folks are always sensitive about the Confederate flag? Can you ever tell me when the Confederate flag is ever shown in a positive light? And these guys are still running around with hoods on their heads, and we say that the millennium's right around the corner. All right. He left the Republican Party. This is some of the news out of Chicago. Buchanan jumped ship. Now, you think he's going to pass off as Ronald Reagan? Y'all vote for me now. All right, another highly opinionated person that's saying it's the last go-round is Charles Barkley. He says goodbye after this season. That should be quite interesting. He's always been noted for not necessarily his style of play, but rather some of the comments that he used to make. All right, Gateway to Monrovia is going to be a reality. Huntington and Myrtle, they're going to build a complex there. Huntington Millennium Center. Now, don't you know Millennium is 2001? All right, all you couch potatoes out there, Did you vote in the school board election? Can you name the three candidates that'll be sitting on the school board seat? New faces? Oh, just me. I can't get it right. I'm struggling with it. I ain't the cameraman. Stay with me. All right. We have Cash. Where you at? I'm struggling. All right. We know Cash right there. All right. Roger made it back. Had a brief scare. Yeah, you got it now. And the winner with the most votes was Betty Sanford. That's right. Betty headed the list. All right. All right. And the San Gabriel Valley had a story on it. Okay. Sanford, incumbents, win Monrovia school board race. Okay, a few comments in there by Ralph Walker, but we won't even get into that, okay? All right, what do we have next down here? Those Wildcats are still maintaining a nice win streak at Monrovia High School. All right, some people are not going here. You know what? I have to use this one here. This is a classic. We're going to miss this guy when he leaves office. Can you get a tight shot on that? That's Bill Clinton. He's working on the internet. Do you think he got email from, what's her name? Monica Lewinsky? I know some people are going to hate me for that, but that's all right. A little laughter goes a long way. All right, here's another one that sort of caught my eye. That sort of looks like Joan from the Unity Center, right? Guess again. No, it's the owner of the Rams, Frontier. I believe that's the name. All right, what else do we have here? All right, you know what we got lined up for you? Halloween just passed. And you know, KGEM has this annual Halloween treat. But you know what? There were some rude guys that came through the door. This is Monrovia's most wanted. Let's take a look at that tape, Dayhan, and see how it was, how it happened.
Turn towards the camera.
All right, I'd like to say, where are you supposed to be?
A host. I'm the lady without a costume. I'm not asking for
You're
candy,
though. You're a
hostess.
Though. I'm a host.
I'm not asking for candy. I'm just taking it.
What's all this? Okay. Okay, easy on it. Easy on it, guys. Here you go.
A little bit more.
All right. The more makeup you put on, the more candy you get.
Phone check.
All right, phone check.
All right, now, if you know those young men that's displaying that obnoxious behavior, could you have them...
That's what you call a candy raid.
Candy raid, that's what they call it. If you know those young men, could you have them come back and apologize for that rude behavior? I'm pretty sure their parents didn't raise them to be that way in the public. And you know what? Well, I'll let my guest that's circling underneath the cameras and everything join me right now. How you doing today?
Hey, Ralph.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to have Rob Chapman.
It's great to be back.
Executive Director for KGEM.
Community Media of the Foothills.
All right.
So
that's
the name.
That's covering a wide territory when you say the foothills, right?
That's right.
From Altadena?
Up to Santa Barbara.
Up to, oh,
no.
The foothills run how long?
It's the San Gabriel foothills, you know.
Okay, all right. I'm pretty sure. I think I run up and down them. Hey, something was in the mail. Maybe you could share this with the viewer.
Oh, my. Should we do this?
Okay. Live TV.
Just
let's see what's going
on the air. We have a wedding coming up in KGEM.
A wedding coming up. Who do you think is getting married?
Anybody want to call out and make a guess?
I don't have a... If it's on the 19th, I think I'm going to be a part of it.
Oh, no.
You know, the best man is more than just a movie.
It's on the 20th.
It's on the 20th. Oh, God, I better keep up with it. It's on the 20th. Who is that person on the 20th?
Some of you may know him. He's our studio manager here at KGEM, Erwin Murr. And we'll be tying the knot a week from this Saturday. And our biggest congratulations and warmest
Congrats to the wife, and the wife to be is
Catherine.
Oh,
we're working on the last name.
Yeah, say the last name.
I can spell it. Andrade.
Andrade, don't want to butcher that name up, but we wish them the very best, okay?
Congratulations.
All right, Rob, to the viewers out there, anytime you want to call in, you can, 357-6787 or 357-0850. This is what you call like my sign-off show, in a sense, if anyone believes that. I've been involved with Talk TV for maybe a year and a month, and I thought I'd open up the the time slot for another.
I guess that's why I'm here, because I'm partly kind of responsible.
Yes, you put me out there. So this is a wrap. So any viewers, if you have anything that you would like to talk about, if you'd like to bring up the school board race, if you'd like to talk about building along the foothills or whatever, let's start off with you, Rob, talking about what's new at KGEM.
Well, obviously there's a new name, which is kind of getting old now, but people are starting to learn it, I think.
Okay. Yeah. Community Media of the Foothills.
That's us.
All right.
CMF for short.
Now, why the change? Why the...
Because Monrovia Cable Usage Corporation, which is the old name,
yeah,
had implications, which we weren't really, didn't really tell people what we were. You know, people often thought we were a cable company.
Oh, okay.
Monrovia Cable, you know, I get probably one or two calls a day asking for how much to install cable. Hmm. And we're not about that. We don't do that. And we're not a cable provider. We do cable access, obviously, which is KGEM, the channel you're watching here. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, my gosh. Camera said this. Camera faded away.
Guess that. Let's adjust that camera. No, it's easier to do adjust the talent.
Adjust the talent. That's the easiest thing to do. Now let's talk about programming at KGEM. One new show that caught my eye is the Crazy Cook, the chef.
Oh, yeah, Spartacus Cooking Show.
Yeah, Spartacus
Cooking Show. It's got a catchy tune. I sing that theme song in my head all the time now.
Yeah. Now, explain to some of the viewers that may just be tuning in, what basically is that show about?
Well, as Luca explained it to me, he is a Roman, the only real Roman gladiator cooking show
that
exists.
He hasn't fought at the Colosseum or anything, has he?
Spartacus? Oh, yeah. Well, at least he has the outfit for
maybe
it.
Maybe they taste the food he got in the fight, but go ahead.
But basically, Luca is from Rome, and he is doing a cooking show.
Now, isn't he...
Wednesday nights at 9 p.m. is the time to catch it.
And the catch to the show is that he likes to have talent come on the show,
yes,
right?
He needs help. He is a cooking... It's about Rome, and, you know, there's all these passions associated with Rome and love, so he will serenade a housewife or a want lady and help them to cook and learn how to do it. He looks at more as he's there to you know, serve the housewife.
Now, some of the viewers out there probably saying he actually cooks here in the studio.
He sure does. He brings everything out here. Takes him about an hour to set up his kitchen, and he cooks some nice fresh pasta and vegetables right up every Sunday. Well, every Sunday again, every time he comes in.
All right, another show that stands out to me, Rob, is the one I forgot to bring the ad in the paper, and that's a new movie out on the Pokemon. Is that right? I don't know. You're...
There's a movie, I guess, coming out of Pokemon tomorrow.
The movie. That's right. But we have a young person doing a show here.
Actually, he's on a hiatus right now.
Okay.
He stopped doing. He did about 5-6 weeks of a live call-in show about Pokemon. And now he's trying to think about restructuring it. And he's learned quite a bit in that first 6 weeks. And so I think now he wants to rethink about how he's going to do the show.
Okay.
Work on his crew issues and stuff like that. And then make it a better product, I think.
All right. Now, for viewers out there that may want to dive into the waters and do a live show, and I can tell you anything can happen on a live show. Okay?
Except for people calling in, I guess.
They're probably either, I don't know, they might be tuning into the Laker game. We're competing with that.
That's true.
And the Staples
Arena.
And, of
course, we got live stuff going on in the other access channels, too.
That's right. What else is going on right now?
There's a city council meeting going on the government channel. And
any major issues? Nah, no major issues. Do you have any viewers out there? All right. Here's my kids. Oh, Dad, don't start begging these folks to call in. We got any viewers out there? If you're surfing, why don't you stop on 3 and give your views and your takes on... public access, how important is it? School board election, how important was that to you? Living along the foothills, what is life like? Well, maybe if you're just sitting at home and just wondering, why should I call in? Call in because we asked you.
Or you take on Walter Payton, Payne Stewart, and that they say when people die, they die in threes. And that was really strange right there.
How you mean Will Payne and
Yeah, and Payton. Walter. Yeah, that was quite strange. You have anything new lined up for KGEM as we moving towards the year 2000?
New?
Yeah.
Well, we got some, hopefully we'll get some new shows. We're going to start moving into, we got some new classes coming up right now. One of our staff, Jason Lewis, has an advanced production class that's going to be starting next week, I believe, on Tuesday. So for the people who feel they need to make that next step up to learn some more advanced production techniques, he's going to be doing that. Dan, read that poster for me that you put up there.
Okay. Easy to do that. All right. Hot off the flash.
Let's see. Three-class series. It's going to be Tuesdays from 6 p.m. till 9:30. On three Tuesdays in November, well, the 16th, the 30th, and then the 7th.
Oh,
so it's
okay.
Going to be 3.5 hours of intensive advanced production studio. It's limited to five people, so if you want to get in, you got to get in quick. And Jason knows his stuff.
Oh, Jan, he's sort of the wizard of KGEM in many ways.
And we also have the typical ones that I've been doing. Now we have an AVID class coming up this Friday. If anybody's out there, we'll do an AVID
class. Now, what is the AVID class?
AVID is a nonlinear editing system. It's all done on computer and stuff like that,
okay.
Which actually makes it pretty easy. A lot easier than going back to the old,
oh, really?
Old stuff, yeah.
Probably faster, too.
Yeah,
huh?
you can move stuff around. You know, it's.
Oh, even Ralph could get on it, huh?
Even Ralph can get on it. And we're going to get in there, right? 9 o'clock, Friday morning. And then we have the access orientation, which is just for the beginning people who are interested in access, who may not know where they want to do, if they want to do a show or not. Learn a little bit about the policies and procedures here at KGEM, and that happens this Sunday, the 14th? No.
Yes.
Yeah.
Close
enough.
All right. Now
I think it's the 12th and 14th, from 2
okay.
to 5 p.m.
Now, what did some of the viewers out there may ask the question, I don't like the programming at KGEM. What's your take on that?
Do something you like, then. Yeah.
I mean, when you say do something that you like, stretch it out further. What do you mean?
Public access, which is KGEM Channel 3, is for any citizen in Monrovia who wants to produce a show, has a message, has a topic, has an interest that they want to do, and they want to share it with their community. We don't, as the KGEM staff or and the board of directors and the city, don't control the content of what goes on. It's the citizens themselves that they decide what's going on. So if you don't like the programming that's going on KGEM, then you know, it's coming from your fellow citizens, so you need to discuss it with them and start getting a dialogue. And that's part of, one of the benefits of public access is getting people out there and talking about issues with each other. And oftentimes, you get a confrontational issue or something like
mm-hmm.
that. And it may, hurt to talk about it, but it's also important to talk about it.
All right, for example, one case in point might be, let's say, you turn on Channel 3 and you see Louis Farrakhan on there. And he's talking up a storm, and you find that totally offensive to your frame of mind. What can a person do? Do they write in? Do they pick up the phone?
Besides the obvious one?
Turning the channel.
Turning the channel.
But sometimes people can become gravitated to something that they dislike. And
well,
how
first of all,
more,
I think that the persons who's putting that show out there need to hear that from them.
Mm-hmm.
They're hearing from their fellow citizens, so you need to get in touch with the person who's sponsoring that particular show that you're having a problem with and need to talk it out with them and get involved in what's
mm-hmm.
happening on the station and get involved in the message that's being sent out and stuff like that.
Now,
so,
should they just call or should they write a letter to make it official?
I think the written word is much more powerful, so
mm-hmm.
I always encourage people who have an issue with the program to write something down for me. It's going to get... It has more substance to
it.
It
has traceability, too.
Yeah, and it gives accountability, and it just says that I'm not afraid to sit up there and write down what I think and feel and want to be heard. So I think it pulls more weight. I have a record of the that I can keep in a file, and if enough citizens come across a particular show, I can go to the producer of that show and say, look, this is what your community is saying to you.
Mm-hmm.
Or how are you going to address this? I mean, you obviously need to respond somehow, at least I think you need to respond somehow.
Mm-hmm.
So,
now live shows, do they present a problem to you as a executive director? Do they pose a problem with people calling in? And
I wouldn't call it a problem or anything like that.
Well, a challenge, an opportunity.
It's different circumstances. You know, you might have somebody, it puts a potential out there for some, you know, goofball calling in and making fun or something like that, or saying some bad words or something like that, or saying something that, you know, racist or, you know, bigoted or, you know, or hateful. And that, you know, that's, it's a, you're putting yourself out there in the community, which is, you know, which can happen, you know, and as anybody, any, you know, politician or somebody puts themselves out there or puts their views or opinions out there, you may have people that don't agree with it who were going to confront you or, you know, it may not even be that valid of a point. It might just be that they're goofing around or something like
well,
that.
Well, I just thought of that point, how we somewhat started the show with the Halloween kids coming in and being rather impolite, and to put it simply, rude, okay, taking fistful of candies and stuff. Now, they probably didn't even think that they would be captured on camera. Or then again, they probably thought that they would, but it would be cute, not realizing that anything that you do in front of a camera is captured and can be played again. So they should think twice, because that is an annual event that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And it's great for the community, I think, for the young people and adults to come in and say, this is me on Halloween, and I enjoy it, and this is somewhat of a safe haven. So you guys out there need to stop and think about what you do when you do it, okay? Maybe scared to call us away a little bit. Now, my daughter Rachel, she wants me to go. Some people may be wondering, why do you have this sign over your shoulder, Rage Against the Machine? They're going to be appearing sometime in L.A. And she asked me, hey, why don't you come and take me to the concert? I'm like, Rage Against the Machine. Oh, they're pretty good. The Battle for L.A. is their new CD.
The new disc, yeah.
And it's pretty good. It's pretty good. I enjoy it. I don't know if I could hang with the crowd. Maybe maybe a little bit
I find that now that I get older, I like watching concerts on TV, you know, where the audio's great, you don't have to deal like hours of getting into it and stuff like that, and you get the nice close-ups, because now I'm like sat there and back up there in the nosebleed section going, I can't see, you know.
Well, a friend learned me a trick.
I'm watching big TV screens anyway, you know.
A friend told me a trick is that when you go there, you buy some earplugs, and you put them in there, and it's like good enough. It cuts that sound down.
Yeah, I used to work
volume.
As a stagehand for some, you know, that was a big thing for the stagehands who may not necessarily agree, like the music that's going on. You know, I remember, I did one concert for Vanilla Ice. He was big.
Ice.
And it was a small venue in Vermont, which and he couldn't fit all his equipment out there. And he said he's got to get everything into the hall. So he had stuff lined up behind the bleachers and stuff like that. And he had it so loud that it was just like, you know,
wow, vibrating,
eardrum breaking kind of stuff.
Now, let me ask you a question. Being involved with public access, how is Monrovia as a community in this involvement? Is it really embracing public access, or is it typical for...
Well, it's on the standards of Southern California, I think it's an amazing, it does an outstanding job. But I come from the Northeast, where access is much more vibrant, and so my perspective is a little bit skewed, but I actually thought that probably Monrovia was more of a mid-level access center. But then when I actually see other communities around it and see what Monrovia has done a great job with what it has and has gotten involved. And the city councilors have been supportive, the staff, the city staff has been supportive. The citizens have generally been really supportive. So I think that, you know, it's easy going over to Duarte or Katy or someplace like that and seeing what they have for public access, and you know Monrovia is doing, you know, outstanding, shining little access center here in LA County or in the Southern California.
All right, now, not to rain on that parade, but what could Monrovia do to empower themselves even more? Because I know you're a guy that really likes for the community to empower itself when it's covering different events. What does Monrovia need to do?
I think that more people need to come out and learn how to use this powerful tool, this powerful communications tool known as television. Mm-hmm. You know, if you have, I mean, I just don't think too many people out there just sit back and just, you know, television is just coming one way.
Oh, one way.
One way, and it's like, you know, it can be both ways as it is. here if anybody would call up and say hello to us out here tonight. But
lay the phone down. Yeah, it works.
But you know, getting up off that couch, going out, and thinking, you know, say, you know, I got something I wanted to talk to somebody about or something like that. Even if it's just, you know, my street, you know, there's this problem on my street. You get a few people together on that street talking about it, and you know, people don't hang out on their porches anymore talking about, or you know, at the store or some
at
location.
At least not in Southern California.
No, it's all now their computers and their video and their television, and you've lost that sense of community. So I think that access can be a really important tool in making sure that we come back around to that, so that people are communicating. And maybe your neighbor, we're talking to, you know, everybody out there in Monrovia. We're not talking to people on my street or anything like that. So your neighbor might be across town or something like that you're talking with, but it's all one community. So it's a great, important thing to be able to do, is to get out there and talk to your neighbor.
And I think that's the uniqueness of Monrovia. 13 square miles, 38,000 people in climbing, maybe 39 as we speak. It's the right size to really use this media to educate and to promote various issues that we may be confronted with as a community.
And that's, you know, one of the things that I have is, you know, I'm obviously a big advocate for community media and stuff like that. So I want to see all these things happening for the community. But, you know, I have a small staff. We're a small nonprofit. We don't have the large funding.
People don't believe it. How many is your staff? What is?
We have 2 full-time people. And 4 part-time.
Wow.
And then we have a full-time person on loan from the cable company.
And people always want you to cover events, right?
Cover events, and I have enough trouble just getting my staff to cover the studio for the hours we're open in the studio. So, you know, people think, well, we got a news station right here in Monrovia called KGEM. There's some news going on down there. You know, I did my part. I called the tip-in.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, come down and get a camera and go cover it. You know, we have cameras right here, but I you know, it always... We do our best with the short resources on staff that I have, and that. But you know, if we could get more of those people out there, more of the citizens out there, volunteering their time, and you know, and we get a lot of stuff from the kids around.
Yeah,
the kids do a great job, and you know, I nothing better than seeing young kids learning a tool that's a communication tool.
Right, and they have all that raw energy.
Yeah.
And I have to say a word out to Tom Rialli. He always does a tremendous job in promoting the children to use their creative talents, whether it's the football games or the yearbook that he puts together or science projects.
And sometimes it's hard, I can't believe I'm like older now. It's like I'm 36, but I'm feeling older. And it's like I don't understand that music or stuff. What the kids are into? Yeah. Why can't you listen to something? And you need to just hope that they get past it and tolerate it and say, all right, you got to get them engaged, and that's the thing. You know, it's like you can't get them engaged in something they're not going to be interested in. So if you want to say, all right, you're going to do a show about hip-hop music or something like that. So,
Well, it becomes a two-way street. You know how you talked about that television going this way. It's a two-way street. It's not a one-way street. And when you have a teacher or a professor involved in teaching young people, it's also a learning experience for him also. You stay young. When you work with young people. Now, tell some of the viewers out there about KGEM has a new segment that they do that is actually open to the community, saying that if you have some news, only thing you need to do is what?
Come by. There's a reporter's agreement that says, I'm going to be bringing stuff for the news. Community News on 3 is the name of the program that Ralph's referring to, and we do it every 2 weeks, and anybody who wants to come in off the community has something to report or something they want to add to the news, then they can add it and get it included in there.
So if they have, let's say an event is going to be taking place sometime next week, can they actually come down and sit in front of the news desk and say, da-da-da-da-da?
Of course they're not going to want it, they're going to want you to do it, Ralph.
No, if Ralph ain't here, they'll do it. So, or if they have pictures that they would like to share with the community. So you don't need any VIP pass.
Nope.
You just need...
You don't need any resume of being in front of a camera or anything like that.
Just show up.
Just show up with the information.
And we'll nurture you through the process.
Well, give a call first before you show up at the door and let us know when you're coming. But but come on down anytime.
Now, it's funny because I think there was a recent article in the newspaper that said that Monrovia is that great testing ground for the nation.
Oh, yeah?
That what happens here happens throughout America. So there's a lot of shops and there's a lot of business that look to Monrovia to see how we interact and what do we do towards new projects and different things like that. So in many ways, we're being watched by even a bigger audience in a lot of ways. And I was doing the live talk show, Talk TV, and I used to do a thing for the couch potatoes and the roll-in with the news for those folks that don't read. And it's so funny because, you know, Jay Leno does a thing on the news quite similar, okay, a little bit more polished because he has a bigger budget and he gets paid, okay? Public access is for volunteers, so you can be more creative, all right? So I find in a lot of ways that maybe those bigger guys look at public access sometimes.
I'm convinced. I mean, I saw, I had a friend that I was doing a show with back in Vermont, and we were doing stuff on his show, and then 6 months later, I'd see it on David Letterman.
See, they...
And I'm like, is it inconceivable that Letterman has some staff who's out there just watching, checking out stuff that, you know, kind of fun, cool things that are happening on other places,
yes,
like that,
right,
and making it their own.
And then when also when you you look at the political scene right now, it's sort of flat right now. I mean, Hillary's running for the Senate. We sort of knew that was going to happen. Bill Clinton's been a good guy, I think. No, as we speak, he's been a good guy.
Still in office.
Still in office. And so it's nothing really for the comedians. Unless it's Chris Rock. And he was talking about the fiasco with the fight coming up as we speak. I think it's this weekend. Lennox Lewis and Holyfield. He's supposed to be fight two, right? The first one was sort of strange because everyone swore he lost, but there was a draw.
Oh, I remember hearing about that.
Yeah. So there's nothing really going on for these comedians to really to sink their teeth in. So you probably figure they sitting at home, and a lot of them live in La Cunada, a lot of them live in Monrovia, Pasadena, and they work in the entertainment industry.
Mm-hmm.
So they had that little remote, and they be going, hey, check that out. That's pretty creative. One thing comes to mind is the Blair...
Witch Project?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that looks like something a lot of young folks do on public access. Not sometimes, all the time.
Yep.
You know, but they laughed all the way to the bank with that one, right?
As I understand it, that was a great media marketing ploy.
Yeah, yeah. I think it first showed at the Sundance Movie Festival. Then a guy bought it for $1 million, and then he marketed, and he ended up getting what?
And they made outrageous amounts to turn, you know, triple digit numbers on that. Numbers on that.
And then they timed it so perfect that they released
it. Did you watch it?
Yeah.
Did you get scared?
Well, my kids will tell you I'm a big, somewhat.
I didn't get scared in the big at all. I thought I was ready for this big, scary
but
thing.
But it was greater at home
to watch
it.
And I was like, the fools, they can't get out of the woods.
Yeah. But it was greater to watch it.
Yeah.
Home. Rather than the movie theater.
And I was, you know, I appreciated the fact that they really stuck to the concept of, and they made it looked good. Although as a video person, I kept seeing little things.
Wait
a minute, that was a jump cut there. There's no way that could have happened.
Yeah.
It was.
But it served a purpose, and now it makes Hollywood realize that, hey, you know what? We're not spending all this money to make a movie.
That's the thing. You don't really. I mean, it's getting to the point now where media, where video. I mean, you can do it on your desktop now. They got those new iMacs out there that are desktop video ready. You can get for like $1,500. And people are going to be starting to use this video medium for their phones. They're going to be start using it for presentations at school, for their homework and stuff like that. And that's what part of making sure that the community, that the citizens have access to those tools. That obviously the people that are, you know, the big mega corporations that now run the media and telecommunications in our country, who then control the message. And then you need the citizens, you need that grassroots ability to say, you know, maybe there's a different point of view or a different opinion out there that's not necessarily backed by the big bucks.
Okay.
And so they need to be heard, so.
That voice in the wilderness in some way, which leads to another question. When I look at the KGEM studio, media of the foothills, it looks like it's smaller, or am I getting older? Do you have growing pains? Is it time to expand?
Yeah, we are definitely trying to find a different location. It gets, as you obviously know, is when you tape show this morning. The traffic can get pretty big right through the studio here.
And people hear the sound effects. I should have just said that was another audience person coming in right now. You know, growing pains. How do you tackle that problem?
We're trying to work with the city, and even we'll hope to be talking to the schools and maybe even some of the businesses around town and stuff like that. But in developing some sort of plan, there has been some talk about us going down to Recreation Park and mm-hmm. the armory there and building something down there. But that's going to take a while, so you know, our growing pains are bursting right now, so I'm probably going to be trying to find some sort of maybe even temporary space or something like that. Maybe try to deal with something in the location we're at. But, we're just currently, looking at how we can make it happen, because it really has gotten, in the last few months, the facility is becoming really mm-hmm. popular and very much cumbersome.
And used, which is good.
Yeah, which is great. But, like you said, it's getting to the point where...
It's getting tight.
Yeah.
I mean, also because when you think of doing something creative, like the gladiator guy that cooks and all this mm-hmm. here, you got to think of space. You got to think of props. If you want to be real creative, some people say, well, why don't you have like a little sofa and a desk? And you got to
Because you got to get it up and down and out of the studio in a half an hour.
People don't, I don't think the viewers realize that.
But, that comes from being creative and using what you have instead of thinking about what you don't have. I could do great things if I only had that sound stage down at Burbank.
Yes.
But you don't got that, so you got this, so do something with what this is, and you don't get frustrated. And a theater company that I used to be involved with that I ran back in Vermont, that was the whole concept, was theater. It doesn't have to be spectacular. It doesn't have to be...
Right, simplicity.
Yeah. So you can take it out to the street, you can do it, the idea is the message, there's what you're saying, the spectacle. It's secondary, and too much focus is going on about that.
Hey, we have a call out there. Where, did I lose?
Mine too? Yeah.
Hope I didn't lose that caller.
Call back.
Call back, caller on line two.
That's line two.
No wonder they've been calling, we can't get in.
Call back.
All right, call back, caller.
We hung up on you. We're sorry.
Did I do it?
I think I saw it. You hit.
Okay, man. Need my eyes checked and whatnot. What else is when you gaze into the future, public access, what is its role in the community? Where is it headed to? Where is it going? How is it going to be embraced in the future? We know it needs to go to a bigger facility. We're aware of that. We know that from the recent survey put out by the city that people actually look forward to finding things out on KGEM. So that's a tremendous foundation right there. But what is the future? Where is it headed?
I always kind of want to say the voice of, but it's not the voice. It's like the conduit for the voice. It's mm-hmm. it's the megaphone. It's the amplifier. It's the video cable box or whatever that is, that it's providing you with the tools and making sure that that original idea, that concept of the fact that the community needs to have a voice about what's going on and be able to needs some way to spread that message mm-hmm. or spread that opinion to its fellow citizens.
I know in many ways public access in other communities is the media center, and a lot of information revolves around it as far as dealing with getting information out to the community, be it something the three prongs, through government, through education, or through the community in itself, that role. But I'm trying to look farther into the future and say, where should KGEM be at in the future, and what role should it be playing?
I see it as teaching citizens how to use electronic communications. It's you know, in the future, say 10 years from now, when all your internet stuff and all your television programs converge and all your phone stuff converges into one line that's going into your house, developing and teaching citizens who don't have a background in it and bringing them up to speed and they, making them capable of using these tools is where we're at, you know, and that's what our mission is, and that's what we strive to do.
Now,
it's, you know, to provide civic awareness is one thing, you know,
mm-hmm.
having an awareness of what's going on in your community, giving you access to information, all the things that, you know, and that's where as the future is really, for me, is really concentrated on the fact that you are going to have all these things converging into one.
All right, I'll let you get that call if that's a real call. Go ahead. Keep talking.
That telephone, that internet, that you know, your sitcoms that come down on every weeknight, it's all going to be coming from one place. Let's try this again.
I won't touch it. Mine too. Hello there, caller.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Fine. How are you guys?
We're doing all right.
Oh, I'm a first-time caller.
Oh,
this is your first show? I don't know.
Last show, actually.
Last show.
Last show.
Sorry.
That's all right. Normally, I do a show called Talk TV, and I've been doing it for a year. So I thought, okay, years long enough, I do another show called Conversations in Monrovia, which is a tape show, which is, I think, more my environment in some ways because I can really get off into the guests in a sense. I can really allow that person to give that information out, whereas live show, any and everything can happen.
Yeah, that's right.
Hey, do you watch KGEM?
Yeah, I watch the wrestling show.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's good.
And sometimes that other guy that reports the stuff that's going on.
Never thought about getting up and doing your own show, though?
No. I'm kind of embarrassed.
Why?
I don't know.
You know, when you do your own show, you take on a different personality, you know that?
I wouldn't want to have my own show, but I would like to go on a show.
What show would you like to go on?
On that wrestling show.
Well, you're calling the wrong show now.
Why don't you call them in and call them up and ask them you'd like to go on the show. Do you keep up with wrestling that much?
Yes.
All right, give them a call. I'm pretty sure there's a name and a number at the end of the show.
Yeah.
So give them a call.
Do you like any other shows or do you watch any?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Just that other show, the one that guy.
So what made you call tonight?
I'm sorry?
What got you to get up off the couch tonight and dial that number?
No, because I was like going through the channels. I was watching the Laker game and then I decided to change it to KGEM.
Yeah.
Good.
How are the Lakers doing?
They're doing good. They're winning.
Oh, right. Of course. Mm-hmm. They're gonna come on West Coast Bulls. Go ahead.
So what'd you want? What got you to call?
No, just because nobody was calling.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Feel sorry for us.
You know what? I'm glad you phoned in and made that statement. You know why? Because when I go home or the next day, people say, I was watching the show,
but
you were talking and I was enjoying that, and they just can't get that hand to get to the phone for some odd reason.
Hey, probably they're embarrassed to call. I don't know. I was kind of embarrassed to call.
But it's no problem, right?
No.
Now, if we had a television phone, then it would be different then, right?
Yeah.
We could see the caller.
That's true.
So how do you think one can combat that, to get viewers to call in? What do you think? You need to entice them with something like
prizes.
Prizes, a KGEM cup, okay? Or
10th caller gets.
Oh yeah.
Vegas.
No, that don't work. Trust me, that doesn't work. I want to thank you for calling in.
Okay, thank you guys.
All right.
Bye bye.
See that? There's always someone out there watching.
Oh yeah.
Always someone out there watching, but getting them to commit themselves. It's probably a problem that they have with the schools, with the churches, and with everything else. Why do you think in the 60s there was so much activity in the community as far as involvement, and now you hit the 90s and moving on, there's so much apathy?
I think it is one of the major problems in America is the cynicism. And the fact that Americans turn towards it doesn't matter. And that may be a problem with some bad apples in the government, mm-hmm. who, if you know, who we placed our trust in, and then they just shattered it or something like that. Or it may be just the fact that there's a complacency in the fact that, you know, you're getting your big check, or you're not, you know, you're getting your food on your table, or you're getting enough money to buy stuff so you're happy. And then, but, you know, there's always something to get involved with and something to do in the community. And so
now you touched the nerve on that, because there was an article in the paper that says that people are not as contented as what we think, that there's a rebellion going on amongst the work in the workplace. When you think about all these people are coming to the job with guns and taking their frustrations out on their fellow co-workers, there's a lot more going on than what we realize. So beneath the surface, there's a lot more going on.
That's interesting, because, you know, last week with the two places, Hawaii and Seattle,
right?
Two workplace shootings, and it's just that I think that draws on that cynicism, that loss of or that distrust, or that just feeling that nothing matters, and somehow, I mean, you lived through the '60s. I mean, I was a baby. Mm-hmm. I wasn't really aware of anything going on, but it seemed to me there was a little bit more idealism going on, yeah. A little bit more the fact that we can make a difference.
Right.
If we got together, there's power mm-hmm. in numbers. There's power in what we can do, and maybe there were black and white issues then. You had a war going on, so it was very easy to say, I'm for or against it. So, and you had these lines drawn or something like that. Maybe the lines aren't as easy to draw now. I mean, even in a political sense, you know, who's, you know, America doesn't have that enemy, that Cold War enemy in Russia anymore. So there's a whole, like, you know.
But there are so many issues in the, like, I always look at it like this here. You can't pick up the phone and call the president of the United States. That ain't going to happen. Okay, you're lying, it's probably business.
But you can call the mayor.
But you can call the mayor. You can call any representative on the city council. You can call the school board. You can call various members of the school board.
Did you hear any what the rate was for the voting on the school board?
Well, I think totally, roughly maybe 3,000 people voted.
Do you know what that percentage of that is of registered voters?
Maybe 13. No. Yeah, I'm pushing it at 13. No.
And you think that I think that's a shame, you know, when you think about these people who are actually shaping our children's future and
that's
stuff
right.
like that.
4-year terms now, too. We're not talking about, next year I'll vote. It's like, if you don't want to invest in the future, don't deal with educational issues. Because we're talking about grooming people for the future, and we can't even get involved in that. On that community level is where the strength of where everything happens, is at the community level. And people were sort of, I don't know.
I think it's, you know, my vote doesn't count for anything, you know.
Mm.
It's just what's going to be is going to be, whether I sit on my couch or whether, you know, I get out and try and do something. And, you know, I know activists who have gotten out there for fighting for years, and they get that burnout feeling.
Yes.
It's like, you know, I know and nothing's changed, and
right.
still the same, and I've been fighting this for years, and they get discouraged.
Now, that's sort of ironic when you look around the world at different events that's going on, how sacred people are holding the right to vote and how they're risking their lives, and students are
and
saying...
freedom of speech, too, is another one
right.
of that. You know, you know, I watched the so many revolutions in Europe and stuff like that, with the Cold War ending and stuff like that, where the fights were done, you know, especially in the Eastern Bloc,
right.
were fought over the television station.
Well, as we speak, this is the anniversary of the
Berlin Wall coming down. That's right.
Right.
And people, I think, in America are so used to their rights, and they have, you know, that they think there's an entitlement and stuff like that, that they forget that there's people all over the world who don't have the rights that the American citizens do, and they're fighting for it all the time. And I think we kind of forget that. You know, we've made it we've done our business, we got it, and so we kind of just pulled the ladder behind us or something like that and said, you know.
Well, we need definitely more people in the watchtower. Because my neighbor came over to me and asked me to sign this petition. And this petition was a bill that was somewhere in the House, I do believe, saying that uninsured motorists shouldn't have the right to sue. Now, whoever thought of this bill that if you're an uninsured motorist driving around and you're in an accident, then you could sue someone?
I can tell you who thought of it. It was the insurance companies.
I couldn't believe that, man. You know, I pay insurance, and it's like, if you out there operating a motor vehicle, you should have insurance because of the consequences of what an accident could do. But just think, there's someone is paying off someone that's probably been elected I don't know how many times.
But, I mean, shouldn't anybody have a right to sue? I mean, if there's something going on illegally.
I mean, anyone should have a right to sue, but if you're violating the law, if you're operating a motor vehicle and you don't have insurance,
that's going to come out in the suit. Then it's going to be weighed by, you know, I guess, America's pretty lawsuit happy. So maybe there needs to be some discouragement in the fact that everybody can't just go out and, you know, sue and get $1 million or something like that. But I would think, well, maybe it's just because the system's been abused so many times that we need these kind of things, or people suggest these as solutions.
So public access, as we know, is that voice that's saying out there, if you got an ear to hear, come on and hear. If you can hear it, then also become a part of it in many ways, right?
Now I just came up with a slogan.
Yeah.
The voice of the community.
Yeah, the voice of the community is public access in many ways. Sometimes you hear things that you don't want to hear, like that sound I hear right now that says,
"Oh no,
Talk TV, the final chapter."
That's your cue?
That's a cue.
You didn't get five or nothing.
We don't get five. We don't get that. We're letting you know.
Well, I wanted to thank you, Ralph, for being on the air for this year doing Talk TV.
And to all those viewers out there that did tune in and watch, all right, we appreciate that. But the best way that you can really show gratitude and all that is come on and get involved in KGEM, voice of the foothills, right?
Voice of the community.
Okay, voice media. Of the community.
Voice of the community, media of the foothills.
All right, so come on and get involved. And to my friends at the Buddhist Compassionate Relief Organization, happy 10-year anniversary in the city of Monrovia. Appreciate that, all the positive things that they do. And if you want to see my face again, don't forget to tune in and watch Conversations in Monrovia, the show Monrovians Really Watch.